Good evening. Welcome to the February installment of the St. Joseph's Businessmen's Association's Featured Speakers Series Lecture. We're streaming live from historic McCabe Theater on the campus of St. Mary's Academy and College in St. Mary's, Kansas. It is our great pleasure to be able to welcome those of you who are joining us through the internet, especially the high school boys from St. Mary's Academy. Before I introduce our featured speakers for this evening, I'd like to ask our chaplain, Father John McFarland, to lead us in an opening prayer.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, the world without end.
Amen. Our Lady, Seat of Wisdom.
Pray for us.
Saint Joseph.
Pray for us.
Saint Pius X.
Pray for us.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Thank you, Father. To begin, a couple of notes for our online audience. The St. Joseph's Businessmen's Association was founded in St. Mary's in 2001. It's a lay organization of Roman Catholic men who wish to infuse their professional lives with the Catholic faith and are guided by the social principles taught by the magisterium of the Church. The organization places itself under the spiritual guidance of the priests of the Society of St. Pius X, following the spirit of Archbishop Marcel Lefebvre, defender of Catholic tradition. Membership is open to all traditional Catholic men over the age of 18 who either attend a chapel or support the mission of the Society of St. Pius X. If you wish to join the SJBMA or sign up for our monthly newsletter, please go to sjbma.org and follow the Become a Member links you'll find posted there on the website. Monthly meetings are held here physically in St. Mary's. The list of upcoming speakers is already posted in our monthly newsletter. If you sign up to become a member, you'll get that newsletter. But some of our future speakers are Father John McFarland, Dr. John Rao, and Mr. Christopher Ferrara. This being our monthly meeting, there's a couple of housekeeping notes as well. I would like to remind all of our members that next month is the month of March. So be looking for an email with details on how we will properly celebrate the Feast of St. Joseph on March 19th. We've kind of gotten away from that a little bit in recent years. We're going to go back to giving St. Joseph more honor on his feast day as a group. Concerning tonight's talk, if you're viewing the lecture online, you can type in questions for the speaker in the comments box on the right of your screen in real time throughout the talk. Mr. James Vogel, editor of Angelus Press, will be moderating all online questions. After our speakers are finished with their lecture, they will open up the floor for questions. As our online audience will not be able to hear otherwise, we provided a microphone at the front of the room for anyone who wishes to ask questions after the talk. I'll move it to the center, and you'll have to come to the podium one by one to ask questions. Again, this is for the benefit of our online audience so they can both hear the question and the answer in our video feed. Now, finally, to our featured speakers for this evening, Mr. J. Kempton and Dr. Steven Lantier. The title of their talk, Papa Care, Mama Care, Baby Care. Mr. J. Kempton came to the Kempton Group in 1992 and became president and CEO in 2003. For nearly two decades, he's been working with Oklahoma employers to ensure their employee benefits fit the needs of the community. Mr. Kempton has a Bachelor of Science degree in Business Administration from Oklahoma State University and is life, health, AD&D, and property and casualty insurance licensed in multiple states. Dr. Steven Lantier, M.D., is an anesthesiologist who specializes in anesthesiology. Dr. Lantier is licensed to practice in Arkansas, Oklahoma, and Louisiana as of the posting of this description. Dr. Lantier co-founded the Surgery Center of Oklahoma, where he currently practices anesthesiology. It is my distinct pleasure to welcome Mr. Kempton and Dr. Lantier.
Thank you all for inviting me. I'm really honored to be here. I'd like to thank Don Mills, a good friend in Oklahoma City, that helped me put the slide presentation together. So, first comment is, I think that all of you must have heroic amounts of fortitude. You know that you will voluntarily sit here for an hour and listen to a guy who puts people to sleep is pretty amazing. I think so. I'm pretty mute. I think that to make the lecture more meaningful, I also thought that you might want to know a little more about the psyche of anesthesiologists. So this is supposedly what anesthesiologists think about themselves. I have to say I couldn't disagree more with this characterization. But just in case anyone, to clear up any confusion, that doesn't stand for Steve, okay? Okay. Unfortunately, this is what most people think we are. It's the more slovenly model, and I think that it might be a little more accurate. Okay, tonight we're going to dive into the fairy tale of the three cares, which is Papa Care, Mama Care, and Baby Care. Papa Care, this porridge is too hot. So tonight, this will represent the hot hand of centralized government. High-handed, harsh, haughty, hegemonious, Hegelian, that of a hollow state. I was hoping the alliteration would help dramatize things a little bit. Mama Care, this porridge is too cold. So tonight, this will represent the cold, uncaring, callous care, calculating care of the corporatocracy. So tonight, Mama Care will represent the large hospital systems and insurance companies. Baby Care, this porridge is just right. I will be honest and say I can't tell you what just right is when it comes to health care. But what I'm going to propose is the model of the Surge Center of Oklahoma, and at least as an attempt to get back toward to something that is more sane than what we have currently, okay? So how will we do this? Tonight we're going to answer three questions. Is there a crisis? How did we get here? And the reason we're going to ask how did we get here is because everybody in this room knows there's a crisis in the church, and everybody in this room is different because you've all answered that question, how did we get here? What you've done is you've said, I see Vatican II, I see the new mass, I know about modernism, I know about enlightenment, you can go all the way back to Adam and Eve. The people in this room are different that way. And you know that history, and because you know that history, you know how to solve the problem. So, and that's the third question that we'll answer is, once we know, then what do we do? So the first question then is there a crisis? Oh, sorry, wrong slide. Wrong crisis, I'm afraid. Okay. Okay. Here are some slides that I'll quickly go through, and you'll help me decide if there's a crisis. Rising healthcare costs are unsustainable. This was commissioned by CNBC, not a bastion of conservatism, obviously, and they believe healthcare costs are not sustainable. Here's U.S. healthcare spending as a percentage of GDP. Went from 5.25% there in 1960 to almost 18% in 2010. Okay, again, as a percentage of GDP. Here's a really damaging slide. Went from, here in 1960, and here's what we see, that wages only increased 16% over this 50-year period. But look at healthcare costs, 818%. Okay, Medicare, 1965, zero, that's when it started, up to 3.5%, again, as a percentage of GDP. This is a pretty damaging slide here, bankruptcy, and I didn't have any idea that it was this high, but 62.1% of all bankruptcies in 2007 were caused by medical debt. Really surprising is three-quarters of those were people that had health insurance. Okay? Now, I could present a lot more statistics, but I think that's enough to conclude that, Houston, we have a problem, okay? Healthcare spending is too expensive. And I hope that if there's anything in the lecture that we disagree about, that we can at least come back to here and know that we have common ground at this point anyway in the lecture. Okay, so let's go ahead and get started and see, you know, how did we get here? I put together this chart. What I've tried to do is over about 200 years, what I want to show is how the world, European, and U.S. history has gone from towards centralization, okay, and that medicine has followed it. And then I will give really quickly what the popes did to try to combat this centralization. And then just for completeness sakes, the church triumphant, what heaven did and the Blessed Mother did in her apparitions. But again, we won't have much time to cover that point on the thing. Okay, we'll start with the War of 1812. The War of 1812 gave us the first national sales tax. The Civil War gave us the first national income tax. So 2 points here. One, wars centralize power, almost always, okay? And anytime you see war in any of this list, that's what you'll see. The second point is, there's a paradigm shift between these two wars. You know, taxes tend to inhibit whatever is taxed. So for instance, here for a sales tax, like a tax on cigarettes, right? Well, if it's high enough, it will inhibit people smoking cigarettes. It'll inhibit consumption. From this war to this war, what you had was a tax now on income, so you now are taxing and inhibiting production. Pretty big difference here. Okay. In 1847, the American Medical Association was founded. In my mind, this represents the beginning of the centralization of health care in the United States, just that you're terming it the American Medical Association, okay? It's the attempt to get everybody in the same in the same basket. In 1880, von Bismarck socializes medicine in Germany. By 1900, all states require licensure. Now, that sounds good, right? There's some quality, when you make a doctor become licensed, it can affect his quality and standardization, so there can be some good things. But really, it's a two-edged sword. And what it represents a lot, and I'll give an example, if you make a man get a license, well, that's creating an obstacle. And one of the things that those obstacles do, depending on how difficult those obstacles are, it decreases supply, increases demand, and increases costs. And that really began happening then. And here are some of the untoward effects that happened. In 1910, with 100 million population in the United States, there were 23,000 med students. By 1970, the population doubled to 200 million, but there were only 35,000 med students. So only a 50% increase in med students. In 1910, there were 162 med schools. By 1944, we were down to 69. Okay, so remember that number of 69 med schools in 1944, because it comes up in some other history here in just a second. As we keep going through the history, Federal Reserve 1913, you all know that nationalized our monetary system. World War I, obviously increased taxes that were never rescinded. Russian Revolution consolidates communism. Stock market crash 1929. Here's how these are related. This is pretty interesting. So what we had that preceded that, 1913, the Federal Reserve, they now control the money supply. They loosen the money supply. We have the roaring 20s. Then they tighten the money supply. It causes the stock market crash and the Great Depression. And who was affected most? Retirees. They completely lost their retirement funds. So then that ushers in, you know, the Social Security Act of 1935, FDR's New Deal. So we have the federal government trying to help by creating the Federal Reserve. It hurts, and it makes us then start this, again, move toward, you can call it centralization or socialization, whichever you prefer. Okay, another attempt at healthcare legislation, 1939. World War II comes in on that and really is what stopped this. World War II was significant in also because of the limited workforce in the United States. You know, the people that were left here at home to work, there were wage controls, and so the employers, you know, to try to get them to come and work for them, started offering health insurance, and that really is the beginning. Insurance had some other beginnings, but that would be a whole nother lecture. Anyway, World War II was famous for that, for really giving us employer, you know, health insurance, okay? 1945, Truman proposes national health insurance. It fails, but what does pass is subsidies that went to med schools. Okay? We just said that in 1944 there were only 69 med schools, so now the government is trying to get more, right? So they start subsidizing them. Well, again, it backfired because what happened is the cost of medical educations went through the roof. Okay, because again, using federal subsidies, and what happened is those costs had to be passed on to consumers. Okay, so we keep seeing these steps that just keep adding to the problem. Okay, 1946, Hill Burton gave loans to hospitals. 1960, under Eisenhower, was when the federal government started giving subsidies to states. So then the shell game begins, where the federal government, we have our federal taxes, they send it to the states to pay for health care. Well, why not just give it to the states in the first place, okay? 1965, Medicare comes into play. Lyndon Johnson flies to Independence, Missouri on July 31st, 1965. He goes to the Truman Library and in front of Harry and Bess Truman, signed Medicare into law, gives them the first two Medicare cards for his beginning of the whole process back here. Okay, Obamacare represents a whole new level of socialization, and it would be unfair to talk about the fairy tale of the three cares without at least bringing you know, Goldilocks into the picture here. So, okay, so what I'll have to say about that is Obamacare does represent a whole new level of socialism. But, you know, one of the things that aggravates me is I've just shown you that for 200 years we have let our guard down. And it's our inaction, and I don't care if you're the greatest generation, the generation before the greatest generation, Generation X, we have, by our inaction, allowed all of this to happen, okay? So everybody can blame it on Obama. I despise him too, but again, that's not where all the blame belongs, okay? All right, so what did the popes do to try to rectify some of this? 1964, the Syllabus of Errors, Pope Pius IX responding to the liberalization that's going on in Europe, okay? And the Syllabus of Errors condemns socialism, communism, secret societies, and I quote, "Pests of these kinds are frequently reprobated in the severest terms." What else did Pius IX do? On December 8, 1854, solemnly defined the Immaculate Conception. 1869, the First Vatican Council defines papal infallibility. So in summary, he's clarifying problems and he's defining solutions, and that's what popes should do. The other thing he did was he ushered in Leo XIII and Rerum Novarum. So 1891, Rerum Novarum here represents the first major use of the term subsidiarity as a major public policy. Now, subsidiarity, if I were going to define it in a word, would be decentralization. Okay? A little more formal definition would be a principle, and it is a principle, it's not an idea, that a matter should be handled by the smallest, lowest, or least centralized authority. All right? So, let's jump to Quadragesimo Anno, which means 40 years later. This is Pope Pius XI. And he goes into much more detail on what subsidiarity is. And so I would like to read this in its entirety. Article 79, the most weighty principle, and again, I underline principle because that's what it is. It's not an idea, which cannot be set aside or changed, remains fixed and unshaken in social philosophy. Just as it is gravely wrong to take from individuals what they can accomplish by their own initiative and industry and give it to the community, so also is it an injustice and at the same time a grave evil and disturbance of right order to assign to a greater and higher association what lesser and subordinate organizations can do. So that's it. I mean, that's subsidiarity. And it's so in a way, it's about acting in a local manner, that acting in a local manner is more important than in the, you know, let's say in the federal realm, okay? So in summary, what are the popes doing? They're clarifying, they're defining, they're telling us to act, and they're telling us to do it preferentially in a local way. All right? So speaking of a local way, what I'd like to do now, I want to show you a little bit and move on to what we're doing at the Surge Center of Oklahoma. And again, this is a local, this is what my partner and I and our other, you know, 45 surgeon partners are doing to you know, to go ahead and try to make a difference, all right? So here's a short video. It's going to last about 4 or 5 minutes. It's one of the local news stations did. And I think this will kind of sum up what we're doing at the Surgery Center.
Listen to this. According to Time Magazine, Americans spent a whopping $2.8 trillion on health care in 2012. Even for families with insurance, medical care is expensive. Well, tonight, a special report about an Oklahoma surgery center that is revolutionizing the price of surgery around the world and has some folks shopping for the best deal.
We are all familiar with the concept of a free market. You know the price, you make an informed choice. There's nothing secret about the price of gas or bread or milk.
Milk's fair, very fair.
In almost every case, you know what you'll pay before you buy.
What about medical expenses?
Any idea what a hysterectomy costs?
No, but I'm sure it's outrageous.
Any idea what it costs to get a broken arm repaired?
Very expensive.
Any idea what the price of a hysterectomy costs?
Oh, no.
Any idea what the cost to fix a broken leg would be?
No, I really don't.
That's the problem with healthcare, according to doctors Keith Smith and Steven Lantier. They launched Surgery Center of Oklahoma 15 years ago, founded on this simple principle, price honesty.
What we've discovered is that healthcare really doesn't cost that much, but what people are being charged for it is another matter altogether.
And so Surgery Center of Oklahoma started posting their prices online, all of them. Pick your surgery, see the price. They are all-inclusive quotes, no $5 Band-Aids here, and they are guaranteed.
So when we first started, we thought we were about half the price of the hospitals. And then we find out we're less than half price. And then we find out we're a sixth to an eighth of what their prices are. And we're just shaking our heads going, I can't believe the average person in the United States can afford health care at these prices.
Our goal really is to start a price war.
And it's working. Their first out-of-town patients came from Canada. Soon, everyday Americans caught on. 22-year-old Matthew Gang tore his patella tendon, dislocating his kneecap playing basketball. He's from California. We talked with his dad, Tom Gang, on Skype.
He had no insurance whatsoever. He also had a part-time job, so he didn't qualify for the state insurance plan, Medi-Cal here in California, or the county plan here that we live in.
Surgery in California was going to be about $30,000. Here, less than $6,000, one-fifth the price. So Tom and Matthew flew from California to Oklahoma.
It was well worth it. I need a rotator cuff surgery right now, and I'm thinking about flying out there and having them do my rotator cuff surgery because it was such a positive experience for us.
A handful of other Oklahoma medical facilities have started joining Surgery Center of Oklahoma in price transparency.
And here we've said, in a very radical and unique way, we've said, here is what we do, and here's how much it costs.
Critics are quick to point out Surgery Center of Oklahoma does not take Medicaid or Medicare. They do take private insurance, though, Hospital administrators accuse the surgery center of cherry-picking the healthiest and wealthiest patients, those who can pay.
Where we can reveal information that's meaningful to the patient, we very much support that. That's what hospitals need to do.
Craig Jones is the president of the Oklahoma Hospital Association, which supports transparency, in theory, though Jones calls the issue complicated and does not expect major metro hospitals to offer online price menus in the future.
The difficulty when you compare hospitals with surgery centers, for instance, is that surgery centers have most of the work that they do are elective procedures, and they're a bit more predictable in the sense of what it is that they're going to do.
Still, the difference in price is staggering. We obtained these bills from major metro medical centers. A breast biopsy at Surgery Center of Oklahoma is $3,500. At Mercy Hospital, they charged $16,000. Gallbladder removal at Surgery Center, $5,800. At OU Medical Center, they billed $21,500. A hysterectomy at Surgery Center of Oklahoma, $8,000. At Integris Baptist, that same surgery is more than $37,000.
I think there's a tendency to oversimplify the issue of price comparison. But I think there's no doubt that hospitals are and need to be more accountable to the public to try to make the services and the businesses that they carry out more understandable.
According to the Hospital Association, about half of Oklahoma's hospitals are losing money. But prices these days may be dropping because of Surgery Center of Oklahoma, as patients are demanding price matching. Some hospitals relent.
Hospitals are having to match our pricing because patients are printing their pricing and holding that in one hand and holding a plane ticket to Oklahoma City in the other hand and asking that hospital to step up.
The economics are not as simple as a loaf of bread or a gallon of gasoline, but perhaps not too complicated for patients who are finding ways to save on medical care. Allie Meyer, News Channel 4.
Okay, so y'all saw my partner, Dr. Keith Smith. We started the surgery center in 1997 with about 12 surgeon partners. We were renting a little place that was affectionately known as the Crack House. After about 5 years, we grew so much that we needed to build the facility. It was just on the screen there, 32,000 square foot. We now have 45 surgeon partners, and I guess now we're called the Crack Palace. But anyway, people ask us what makes the Surgery Center of Oklahoma different, and I've kind of narrowed it down to these four things. We do not do electronic medical records. We accept no government money. We have transparent pricing, and we have value, and that's the quality over cost formula. So let's look at electronic medical records. This article, as patient records go digital, theft and hacking problems grow. This article lays out several examples of once your information is digital, it's gone, okay? So Howard University, a medical technologist over 17 months, was selling patient information. Weeks earlier, 34,000 patients at the same hospital were notified that their medical records had been compromised. Days later, the Utah Department of Health had to admit that Eastern European hackers had gotten into their system and compromised 800,000 medical records. TRICARE, the military insurer, admitted that 5 million, that some computer tapes were stolen, affecting 5 million people. A little bit separate story, but still related. The IRS in California took 60 million patient records. And you couldn't do this if it were paper records. Can you imagine what 60 million medical records, what kind of volume that would be? So at the Surgery Center of Oklahoma, we're all about privacy, and as an example, I'll tell the story, and I tell it often. 10 years ago, the health department came in and said, "We want your medical records," and we said, "Well, our patients didn't give you permission to have our medical records," and they said, "Well, we're going to take your license," and they said, "Well, we'll sue you," and they backed off. And for us, the scary part is that every other facility in the state of Oklahoma turned over their medical records. So just didn't even ask, just didn't bat an eye, just gave it to them. So we're serious. Okay, the next three things, accepting no government money. Now, some people, when we first started 17 years ago and we decided we wouldn't take Medicare or Medicaid, they thought, you greedy son of a guns, okay? But it's number two that allows us to do number three and at least this portion of number four, the low-cost part. And here's why. If we took government money and if we took government money, which means Medicare for the most part, we could not advertise because we know that it is illegal. We've been informed by attorneys that we'd be breaking the law if we posted any price that's different from the Medicare price. Okay? So just that we can advertise is really different. I'll talk about another part of that in a minute. So we are encouraging people to follow our model. We want competitors. We want people to do what we're doing. But a lot of people are going to have trouble competing with us because they do take government money, and it already ties their hands behind their backs. Okay? Okay, low cost. Now, how can I say that not taking government money affects our costs? Well, three ways. No cost shifting. Cost shifting means, and here's you just have to take my word on this one, but if we did a knee arthroscopy on someone who has Medicare, okay, I promise you that the price that they would pay the center is less than it would cost us to do the surgery. Now, if that's true, well, what do? You can't operate at a loss, so what do? You shift the cost to people who can afford it, and we've refused to do that. We don't want to play that game with anybody. Less bureaucracy. I promise you, if we took government money, I would need at least one or two more billing people in our office just because of all the red tape that the government gives us. Less compliance with onerous regulations. A good example of that, we would have to have electronic medical records, which I just told you that we don't have, if we were participating with government money. Okay? Okay. To visit just quickly about the quality part of the value formula that I was just talking about, okay? Quality, when you hear the word quality, I tell everybody, danger, danger, Will Robinson, be careful. Quality is one of those things that I will tell you, most quality awards are purchased. If you fly in an airplane and you look in the magazine, what do you see? Top 25 doctors in the United States. Come on, really? I mean, those are bought advertisements, guys. Those aren't right. And here's a story just from 2 days ago. My partner that you just saw in there, Keith Smith, was interviewed by what's going to be the new Larry King show. Okay, and they vetted him for about 30 minutes, asked him all kinds of questions about what he thought and everything. And then at the end, they said, "Okay, well, you can be on the show. It'll only cost you $27,000." Come on, really? Anyway, so the other thing that I'll say is be careful anytime you hear about success rates. I mean, what does that mean? I mean, for instance, again, just these examples kind of make things a little clearer. If I were unethical, I'm an orthopedic surgeon, and I'm doing a knee arthroscopy on somebody who doesn't need a knee arthroscopy, I would hope that my success rate would be close to 100%, right? So ethics has a lot to do with success. I mean, so be careful when you hear those things, all right? We hang our quality hat on. We think we're ethical. We have about a zero infection rate. And the people that refer to us, I mean, we do most of the major college athletes, most of the professional athletes in the state of Oklahoma. So those people have a lot of confidence in us, and that's kind of what we tell people. Otherwise, it's really hard to say, yeah, we're quality. Okay, I'd like to go, and again, changing gears just a little bit. Here's our website. I'm going to take you through an example of what's going on, and I hope you'll be shocked. And Jay Kempton over here, who's, again, heads of TPA, he'll be able to shed a little more light on it, but I want to just go through and be able to show you. I'm going to take the example of a cochlear implant, which at the Surgery Center of Oklahoma costs $8,800, but let me break that cost down for you here. At the Surgery Center of Oklahoma, $8,800 includes the facility, the surgeon, and anesthesia. At the hospital, $25,000. There's one other hospital in Oklahoma City that does cochlear implants. Their facility-only charge is $25,000. The cochlear implant costs us $27,000. We pass that on. We don't mark it up a penny. And for a total cost of $35,800, they triple the charge of the implant to $81,000, total price $106,000. But even so, this isn't apples to apples. This is everything, and this is minus surgeon and anesthesia at least. Okay? So for this example, let's follow this $106,000 bill and see what happens. All right. I call this the love triangle just so you can see who the players are. I've renamed the hospital, Hospital Bank and Trust, for obvious reasons. Here's time for a definition. TPA, third-party administrator. If you hear us say TPA tonight, that's what we mean. Jay Kempton runs a third-party administration firm. For this example, we could have taken and manipulated all kinds of things, but I wanted to use a TPA, which often is an insurance company. Okay, and for this example, you can even assume that it's an insurance company. But they are people who administrate healthcare plans for self-insured companies. Okay, so here is the self-insured company right there, and here's the patient. Okay, so that's the three players in the love triangle tonight. All right, let's follow the $106,000 bill and see what happens. Here is the definition of repricing. This $106,000 bill charge is with fairy tale magic, by the way, reduced to $60,000. And again, that's because the third-party administrator and the hospital have some kind of relationship that sometimes good, sometimes nebulous. But anyway, this employer has a little bit of a smile on his face thinking that he's saved $46,000 at this point. So he's thinking, well, life is good. Okay. Next step. There's a little more to the formula, though, because typically there is a repricing fee, but now Jay Kempton here doesn't do this game, so I must make a disclaimer there. Don't think he's a bad guy. Okay, the employer will often pay a percentage of the savings. So there's a $46,000 difference here, and this guy thinks that it's savings, and so there's a percentage of that cost that is kicked back to the third-party administrator. Now, we've heard that that amount can be as much as 38% of what the supposed savings is, okay? So keeping this at $10,000 for the example, I was being probably very conservative. All right. So at this point of the game, the employer has paid $70,000, a 60 plus 10. He's still pretty happy because he's looking at a $106,000 bill otherwise. The third-party administrator's on his way to the bank, pretty happy. And the hospital, well, they made $60,000. They collected 60. And I'm telling you that it cost them 30. I mean, because I can tell you what everything cost, right? So they profited $30,000 on that deal. All right? All right, here's a summary. $106,000 charge. The employer pays the 70, the imaginary fairy tale savings. He still thinks there's 36%, so he's still pretty happy. He's still smiling. The bank... The hospital, they collected 60, profited 30. And again, we know that just from kind of internal information. And here's where the game gets really sticky. This $46,000 right here is a paper loss. Now, how can somebody write that they've lost 46 when we know that clearly they made $30,000? All right? Well, here's where the game gets really dicey. If you go home tonight and you Google DSH, or Disproportionate Share Hospital, Okay, or you've heard of dish payments. Okay, that is the federal government compensating the hospital at the end of the year for all of these supposed losses. Now, dish payments are mostly for Medicare and Medicaid, but the bottom line is our tax money goes to compensating them for a high percentage of all of these losses that they total up at the end of the year.
Charity care. Yeah.
Okay, so now just to show you how bad this can get and see where their incentives are, just for the heck of it, I changed this to a $200,000 charge. So let's kind of follow that for a second. Okay, his charge was still 60, but now the repricing fee went up, right? Because the supposed savings is 200, you know, minus 60, so 140. So again, I just threw this number in there. It would probably be a lot higher. But on a $200,000 charge, the TPA would make way more money, okay? So in a sense, this employer thinks that now he saved $120,000. It's kind of a psychological thing, even though he spent 80. So in some ways, he thinks that he's getting off better, but he's not. And then over here with the hospital, look at this. Now he will write off $140,000. And now his total at the end of the year is going to be larger, and he's going to get more kickback from the feds. Okay, so it's a completely turned around system, and again, Jay knows from the inside way more about how this works, but it's not good. Okay, all right, that's bad news. Here's good news. Healthcare is unaffordable. Now, I put that in the good news category because healthcare being unaffordable is making people take drastic actions. So let's think about our employer. He is he's looking at this. He thinks he saved $36,000, but what's the truth? I mean, the truth is he can't afford healthcare for his employees anymore. He's having to take drastic actions. And then to the rescue, this is the second part. No, not Spider-Man, but to the rescue is transparency, high quality, and low price. So again, let's go back to the employer that we just had. He now is in the, especially with Obamacare and everything that's going on, he can't afford, right, to get insurance for his employees. And then he looks on our website and he sees, wow, I could have had that cochlear implant for $30,000. So not only did I not save 36, I spent 70 or 80 or whatever, and I could have done it for 30. So it's starting to happen. I mean, this avalanche is really starting to happen. And so this leads me to the other real positive thing that's happening is all of these people, not only in Oklahoma, but in Oklahoma, because of Jay, it's really starting to blossom. These people are following us. So McBride Orthopedic Hospital, I mean, world-class orthopedic care, and they will do what we're doing. Now, they take federal money, so they can't advertise like we do. But Jay advertises their prices for them. All right? So Oklahoma Heart Hospital, world class. We're talking about quality. We're not talking about podunk, you know, people that you know have to give these discounts. So same thing, cancer care, everything. I mean, it's really starting to happen, and it's very exciting. So what I'll say one more thing about this is, since now, and this is organic. I mean, I don't have any relationship with McBride. I don't have any relationship with any of these other people. They are organically coming to the front and doing these things. So the key for you guys, especially businessmen, is that now we can offer, and Jay can offer, a lot of services. I mean, we're not just limited to the things we can do at a surgery center like ours. So major, you know, bypass surgery, major joints, all, you know, made total joint replacements. So it's really happening, and it's kind of fun. So, okay, I think we'll now just go to our last question. So now we know a little bit more about things. So what do we do about it? Well, always, I know the priests are real good about telling us that we put principles into place first. The two principles that we're going to talk tonight about, we've already talked about subsidiarity, and we've talked about inaction, so let's talk about Catholic action, because that's what we need to put into play. St. Thomas Aquinas, the highest form of contemplation or thought is that which superabounds in action. Pope St. Pius X, the subtle raising of multiple questions and the most eloquent dissertations on rights and duties matter little if all this does not end in action. Okay? Epistle of James, chapter 2, verse 17, faith without works is dead. Verse 22, seest thou that faith did cooperate with his works, and by works faith was made perfect. Okay? We are called to act. We're called to do things. So, basing now on the principles, let's look a little more specifically at ideas and suggestions based on these principles. And depending on our duty of state, will depend on those things that we can do. So let me take doctors first. Decrease reliance on government monies. You know, if I'm right that government is the core of allowing this dehumanizing corporatocracy that we see, and again, it's the laws that allow all of these things to happen, right? Well, then it seems like we should oppose or limit as much as we can our reliance on anything that we do with the government when it comes to these healthcare things, okay? So I'm not saying, you know, rebellion, but again, it just makes sense. If they're the cause, well, then let's avoid them, okay? Okay. Reconsider the benefits, downside of hospital employment. Now, this graph may take me just a second to explain, but here's what this is. This is the average net revenue. Okay, these primary care physicians and these specialist physicians are employed by hospitals. Okay, now net. So this is the average net revenue. So after this hospital that employs this physician and his staff and everything, all of his expenses, they generate on average $1.566 million after they pay for the doctor. And why is that? Well, it's because they have this guy, he's an employee, he has to, by his contract, use all of the hospital's labs, all of their services that are all overpriced, just like everything that we're talking about tonight. Okay? So, if you understand the ramifications of this, I mean, it's hard for me to go to any doctor. Now, again, some doctors have to be hospital-based, okay? But it makes it really hard knowing where they're guiding their patients to go because they have to, okay? That is a lot of money. And if you think that every family practice doctor, for instance, that is employed by a hospital generates that kind of income for a hospital, is it any wonder there are cranes out in front of every hospital that you see? And I know it's the case in Oklahoma City, so. Okay. What are the other things? Okay, the other two things, form physician alliances. It's amazing when Jay has a need and he calls us and he says, I need some cancer doctors. And Keith and I will call cancer doctors. I'm on board. Let's go. I want to do what you guys are doing. So it's not hard to form alliances, form guild-like organizations. Here we have the St. Joseph Businessmen's Association. We need to have a doctor association too. All right, businessmen. Now, businessmen, you are the kingpins. I really believe that you are the key to probably this whole problem. And, if I call, and I have before, insurance companies because they're putting the screws on us, they just go, another whiny doctor, no biggie. But if you call and you have 200-300 employees or whatever, they listen to you guys, okay? So I think the power, a lot of it is in this room, actually. What I would say is, Self-insure when you can, and some of you already do. Avoid large corporate insurers, even TPAs owned by large corporations. Now, and again, I will tell you that Jay will be better at this than I will, but talking about repricing, even if you are self-insured, and if you have one of these big major corporations, they're called the BUCAs, Blue Cross, United, Cigna, and Aetna, if they are your TPA, I can promise you there are repricing fees that they are either overtly or not overtly. Lots of these repricing fees are hidden. Okay, they'll hide them in all kind of ways. They'll reprice your pharmacy. They'll reprice rehab, lab, you name it. They are getting money from you. And as a matter of fact, I'll even challenge you all. I almost promise, I almost bet you steak dinner, if you go and ask your TPA, if they're corporately owned like this, to show you a utilization review, I'll almost bet you that they will not show it to you because they're repricing fees. They're getting money on the side. I'll give you an example. I mean, if we charge someone $2,500 for a procedure and they go to the corporation, they say, okay, you owe the Surgery Center of Oklahoma $2,500. Well, they'll take the money, the TPA will, and then give us $1,400 and say, well, this is all they paid us. And that other money is going to them. And again, and they will not show the utilization reviews to the big companies. It's really scary. So just be careful. I mean, those big companies are not like the Jay Kemptons of the world. I can vouch for Jay. When I say associate with like-minded providers, what I mean is honest doctors. If you know honest doctors, stick with them. Form alliances such as buying co-ops. I learned on the way down here that that's not an option for you here in Kansas. Jay has done that. Jay has a bunch of very small banks that could not afford to self-insure and, you know, by themselves, so they have formed a cooperative. This cooperative extends through Texas, Oklahoma, and Louisiana. But again, because of the laws right now in Kansas, which could be changed maybe without too much trouble, you cannot have a buying co-op of people that self-insure together. Okay? So. All right. Families. I only have two recommendations here. Health sharing networks are one possibility. Samaritan is probably the only one that a Catholic in good conscience can use. Some of the others have some statements of faith that you couldn't sign. Samaritan has about a 30-year track record. They're very, very stable. And anyway, it's worth looking up because it is a possibility. Now, probably the toughest thing I'm going to say tonight, because I know there are several families here who have a dilemma, and the dilemma is that because of a need, you're having to use government assistance. Now, again, I'm not your conscience, and I'm trying to be pretty sensitive, but I do see the dilemma. It is a true chicken and the egg. You know, what came first? High costs of health care or government intervention? Well, they're related, you know, regardless of which one came first. So, you know, as healthcare costs increase, it becomes unaffordable, then the path of least resistance is to go to the government, right? Well, the problem, though, is that I've shown you, I mean, over 200 years, as we go to the government, it increased healthcare costs. So it's a vicious circle, and it's spiraling upwards. And so all I plead, I guess, if and when you can, you know, get away from government assistance in healthcare, okay? It's hard. We have responsibility to our families, and that's our duty. But if and when you can, please try to avoid it, okay? All right. Our fairy tale of the three cares, I think, has come to an end. I'd like to conclude with a few thoughts. From a pragmatic standpoint, we have to act, and it's kind of fun. We all like to feel like the hero, you know, crushing the bad guy. But we're really called to act, you know, on a spiritual level also. And for this, I'll just quote Pope Pius XII. There's no time to be lost, The time for planning and reflection is past. Are you ready? The fronts opposing one another in the religious and moral sphere becoming clearly distinguished. It is time for intense effort in which even a few moments could determine the victory. So now from our fairy tale, I think we are pulled back hard to reality. Okay? And where else do we look for our reality? The Blessed Mother, you know, in Fatima. In virtually all apparitions, you know, is asking us to pray and do penance as a solution to all of the woes, you know, not just health care, but to war, to abortion, to euthanasia. And it seems to me that the crisis in the church is really the same crisis that we have in health care, that they're one and the same, and that heaven has the answer. So, again, this is what I believe, is that until we give God his due in worship and in obedience to his divine will, that let's just say that health care may be the least of our worries. Okay? So, that's it. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Steve. That was great. As Siva had introduced earlier, my name is Jake Kempton, and I own an independent third-party administration company in Oklahoma City. And I wanted just to thank you all and everybody here to allow us to come and talk to you all a little bit tonight about healthcare and some of the things, the good things and the bad things that we see out there. Steve kind of painted a few pictures, and I'll try to talk a little bit about what we do and in our role in the business of employee benefits, and then also talk a little bit about the free market and transparency and how it can improve what I feel is the healthcare universe, not only for individuals but also for employers. A third-party administrator, Steve talked a little bit about that. I'm going to just back up briefly to start for those of y'all that maybe are not super familiar with that concept or that term. A majority of employers a majority of employees in the United States that have benefits through their work, a majority of them, about 60% of them, of those employees, get their benefits through some sort of a self-insured vehicle or self-insured mechanism. In other words, they're not buying insurance from the big insurance companies. They are actually paying their employees' health insurance claims out of their corporate assets. Most companies don't know a whole lot about paying medical bills or evaluating medical providers or administering a health plan. And so they look for a third party to assist them with the payment process of paying or processing the claims that their employees have when they go to the doctor or the hospital. And that truly is where a third party administrator comes into play. A lot of insurance companies, like the BUCA, as Steve said, Blue Cross, United, Cigna, and Aetna, have gotten into the self-insurance business with a great fervor over the last 10 or 15 years. And so a lot of insurance companies sell insurance, and they also sell administrative services for self-funded employers. And so you'll see kind of a dual role. Being that my company, I own it, I run it on a daily basis. My father started the company in 1969, and I'm just trying not to screw it up too badly. As a second generation, I think they say the third generation is usually the end of most family-operated companies, but I'm trying to keep the wheels on it. But I don't know whether we were too ethical or too stupid, but we never were invited to this repricing party that apparently other TPAs, as Steve talks about, have all been enjoying. We did things pretty simply. I employ 35 employees, so we're not a big company. And we always felt very principled in the way that we charged for our services. My dad always viewed it as, you know, we're just providing a clerical service for employers that have decided not to buy insurance. And so we structured the way that we get paid very simply. And that is we get paid on a per employee, per month basis. If you're a client of mine, you pay me, maybe you pay me $30 per employee per month. Doesn't matter how many claims I pay. Doesn't matter how few claims I pay. It doesn't matter if I'm paying big claims or small claims, or you're having a great year as an employer or a horrible year as an employer, I get paid the same amount. And I think that aligns my incentives with my employers out there. A lot of insurance carriers, insurance agents, big hospitals, they have a real problem with the alignment of their priorities. A lot of TPAs are involved in these repricing schemes that Steve talked about. Also, a lot of TPAs and insurance carriers, as you all know, their income is sometimes is based on a percentage, either a percentage of a hospital bill or the percentage of the cost of the insurance, right? And in the form of a commission. That's pretty problematic, I think, because the incentives now become when you as an employer or your employees have high healthcare costs, then who wins? Either the insurance carrier, your agent, or the big hospital. Those are all the folks that win when healthcare costs are high. So that was very, very frustrating to my company and to my employers. As Steve said, I do a lot of business with rural community banks. We do business with a lot of other employers, but mainly our company was started providing self-insurance administrative services to rural community banks in Oklahoma and Texas. And I've spent a lot of time out talking to little rural bank presidents, and there may be a bank, maybe some bankers from St. Mary's here in the room, I'm not sure. But I've talked to enough of those employers through the years that say, you know, we've given our employees a raise every, you know, year or two. We try to be a good employer and try to provide raises whenever we can to our employees. However, they never really see it in their pocket because their health insurance costs, their health plan costs go up by the same amount or more. So even though I'm paying more money as an employer toward my employees' benefits, they're making less and less in their take-home pay. And it's pretty gut-wrenching. You know, I don't know about rural Kansas, but I'm sure it's a lot like rural Oklahoma and rural Texas. And so that really kind of started a kind of a righteous indignation in me. And I felt like, you know, there's got to be a way. Everybody that is involved in this healthcare world, when bad things happen to the employer and the employee from a cost perspective, there's a lot of winners that are created out here. And I didn't feel like that was right. So Steve wanted me to kind of tell my story about how we came to know each other. And I think it's a good story that'll hopefully leave you all be very thought-provoking. But as we had this frustration, this indignation in our minds about how could we help our employers out there, because again, we don't get paid more when they have a bad year. We have happy customers when we're able to control their healthcare costs. And so we started looking for some answers. We knew about hospital repricing. We knew that healthcare costs, in my 22 years of doing this, healthcare costs have never been flat. They've always been increasing. We also started seeing, you know, things like maternities and MRIs. Those are X-rays. You know, X-rays is a good example. You know, X-rays that's a technology that's been around for 60 years. If you get an X-ray at your veterinarian on your pet, you know, they might charge you $10. And we see hospital bills that have gone from $200, $300 to $800 for a chest X-ray. And we're saying the costs aren't going up. It's just what they're charging is going up. So we became very, very, very frustrated with this. And I would have employee meetings with my employers and forum very much like this. And I would rail against, you know, the big hospitals and rail against the fact that employees don't know what things in healthcare should cost. Not only do they not know how much they should cost, they have no mechanism to find out what things cost before they buy it. It's the only thing that we buy as Americans that we don't find out what we paid for it until we've already use the service. So as I'm railing against though the woes of the reality that we see, one of my employers that was in the audience said, you know, there's another guy that I know that is very frustrated about all these things, and he's so frustrated about it, he's kind of done something crazy. And you talk about there's a lack of transparency, a lack of accountability in healthcare. This guy runs a surgery center that posted all their prices online. I said, that's I can't hardly believe that, because that's facility's about 10 miles from my company. And why didn't I know about this? And that crazy person was Steve's partner. Steve and Dr. Smith, and they had started posting their prices online, and they were bundled, and that's hugely important. You know, again, it's we buy things in this country. The analogy that I use is buying tires. When we go out and we need a new set of tires for our car or for our pickup truck, you know, we don't really care what it costs a tire center in electricity to run the air compressor to put the air in our tires. We don't care what it costs per lug nut. We are interested in what is the price for four radials, mounted balance, road hazard warranty out the door. But that's not how healthcare is sold. It's not how it's bought, except at this place. So I said, well, I've got to know this person. So I made an appointment to meet with Dr. Smith, and it must have been a slow day at the surgery center because he agreed to see me. And we sat down in their conference room, which also serves as a lunchroom, boardroom, and Steve and Keith's office. I was a little surprised by that. I didn't see it was not some marble hall like you see at a hospital. And we got to talking a little bit about this, and they were very skeptical of me. They said, are you an insurance guy? I said, well, not really an insurance guy. Would you work for Blue Cross? No, I don't work for Blue Cross. How about a PPO? No, I don't work for a preferred provider organization either. I'm just an Oklahoma company that works with Oklahoma employers, and I'm a self-insured administrator. And so they started to loosen up and started telling me a little bit about their pricing that was on their website. I said, you know, but those are not good for insurance. That's only good for individuals. The uninsured, wealthy oil execs, you know, whoever could go in and afford to pay the prices. And I started looking at the prices, and being that it's my business, I was blown away, but because some of their prices were 50 to 70% less than the prices that we were paying on behalf of our employers at the big hospitals. And also, to add insult to injury, we were also paying a PPO, or a preferred provider organization, fee for negotiating those horrible prices for us. So I was feeling quite abused. But as my tongue is, you know, hanging down, and I'm starting to salivate over this pricing, he said, but that's not for insurance, and that, you know, you can't have access to that because it's only for cash-paying customers. And I was like, well, you know, Dr. Smith, you know, your prices are amazing. I mean, they're screaming great deals, but I don't know a lot of rural bank tellers that can pay $8,500 for a hysterectomy, even though maybe it's $60,000 at the hospital. So as we were talking, we kind of hatched kind of a righteous scheme in the way I look at it. And since this was only for cash paying customers, I said, you know, by and large, my employers are cash paying customers, comes right out of their revenue. And we said, well, Dr. Smith, if I can make my employer's employees, when they come to your surgery center and need a procedure, if I can make that Susie Teller, when she walks through your door, if I can make her look, smell, and taste like a cash-paying customer, can we have access to your pricing? And essentially on a handshake, he said, yeah, we'll give it a try, but, you know, no insurance gimmicks. No, you know, you're not going to renege on the deal. You're not going to try to, you know, get a discount on my cash discounted price already. I said, no. I'm not that sophisticated. I said, these prices are great. We'll pay them at 100%. In other words, we will look like that cash paying customer. I'm going to pay you quickly. Usually it's within 7 days, no more than 10. And we pay the price that's on their website. And the way we do that, obviously, is for our employees of the employers that we do business with, we waive their deductibles. We waive their copay. We waive their coinsurance. It is quite literally free for those employees. And so again, on a handshake, it started with a handshake. Now we have an agreement, a very formalized agreement. It's an entire 2 pages long that essentially codifies this handshake. And so we started embarking on this little experiment. And the volume kind of started off kind of slow, and then it started to build. After about 3 months of that, and we were very happy, and we felt like we were really being able to bless a lot of our employers and employees out there, because these are people that, you know, they struggle with meeting those deductibles. And as prices go up, what's one of the only tools you got in the toolbox to lower the cost? Raise deductibles, which just passes more of the cost onto the employees. So we did that for 3 or 4 months. And this is where the magic starts to happen. After 3 or 4 months of this, Surgery Center of Oklahoma, for those of y'all that don't know Oklahoma, their facility is located on Broadway Extension, which is kind of a main thoroughfare between a bedroom community called Edmond. It's kind of a little bit of a higher end community, and then Oklahoma City. And there's a lot of medical providers along there. They have a next door neighbor, which is, as Steve said, is the world-class McBride Orthopedic Hospital. They are a full hospital. They're a bigger facility. They do a lot of total joints, a lot of inpatient, complicated orthopedic procedures, spinal stuff, total joint replacements. They also happen to be a customer of mine. They're one of my employers. They're one of our crown jewels employers. They're a large employer for us. And so after 3 months of paying their prices in cash very, very quickly, I get a call from the CEO of McBride Orthopedic Hospital. And he's not happy with me. Jay, this is Mark. Hi, Mark. What can I do for you? He said, well, I'm not very happy with you because I know what you're doing with this surgery center next door. They're a competitor of ours. And I understand that you're paying their charges at 100%. You don't do that for us. And I've about had it because it just happened to me today. We had a patient scheduled for surgery at our facility, and they up and canceled the day before the surgery because they said they were going next door to get it for free. That, in the healthcare world, that doesn't happen. I mean, people don't up and make a choice. They generally go wherever their doctor, their primary care doctor has told them to go. And so when he had a few of these people cancel and walk next door, he had a problem. He was getting ready to solve that problem talking to me. And I said, you know what, I don't like it. And I said, well, you know, Mark, I said, I don't have any special arrangement with them. I'm simply paying the price that they post on their website. It's available to anybody. It's available to old Joe walking down the sidewalk that's uninsured. It's available to anybody. We're just paying their cash pricing. He said, well, okay, can we do that? And, you know, I did get my degree from Oklahoma State, but I was able to see the magic that just occurred. And it was, I had a hospital CEO, maybe for the first time in America, at least in a generation, has now asked my permission to run his business like a business. Can you see that? He had a need to compete directly with his competitor, not distilled through some insurance negotiation or some insurance contract. It was, I need to be able to post my prices as well because I want to try to emulate what they're doing because I want to quit losing patients. I said, Mark, you don't really need my permission to do that. That'd be great. We'd love to see. They said, all right, well, send me your fee schedule and I'll see if I can agree to it. And that's when the next light bulb went off in my head. I was like, wow. There really something special is happening right here on the phone. And that is, I never gave Surgery Center of Oklahoma a fee schedule. And what that means is, you know, most insurance carriers, they come up with a price sheet and then they slide it across the desk at you and say, take it or leave it. That's usually the way that happens. If you're a giant hospital, you have some negotiating power. If you're a smaller facility, you either take it or you leave it. And so when McBride Orthopedic Hospital said, well, send me your fee schedule and I'll review it. I said, Mark, remember, I didn't give Surgery Center of Oklahoma a fee schedule. So, well, how did you come up with that pricing? I said, I didn't. The insurance guy didn't come up with the pricing. They came up with the pricing on their own. I'm sure that they looked at their costs. They built a reasonable return into it that they felt was still competitive, and they posted it online. So anyway, at least in our little neck of the woods in Oklahoma, that was the kind of the spark that ignited, in the way I view it, this beginning of a functioning healthcare economy. About 6 months after that, we got another phone call, and it's from Oklahoma Heart. Basically the exact same story. They said, you know, we've offered cash pricing before, but we've only offered it to Canadian patients. Would you be interested in it for your Oklahoma patients? I said, well, I don't know, send it over. And I looked at it, and I was stunned at the pricing. It was amazing. It was wonderful. Again, the catch is you've got to pay it at 100%. You've got to put those providers back into the cash business so they can start to operate more like a cash, just like you all may run a hardware store. But the beauty of this is that we've been able to couple an employee benefit plan with this, with the free market, and we are providing, we provide to the patients and to the employers the pricing. I can actually show you what the pricing is. The Kempton Group, we just simply sanity check the pricing to make sure that everybody is kind of competing in an appropriate manner. And I've got to be able to go back to my employer groups and say, if you were to waive deductibles and copays and coinsurance for your employees to utilize these facilities, you will still be in a better position than going to the big hospital and getting the PPO discount. And so far we've been able to do that. We started with one facility. In the video that was shown, I think there were four or six facilities. As of right now today, we have 14 facilities that are doing this, and this is becoming an organic movement. The bottom line to our employers that are doing this, their employees are starting to catch on. Obviously, the employees love it because it's free. But the other side of this is they're starting to become price aware. In other words, they understand now, and slow, but employees understand that a shoulder MRI should cost a good price, not a great price, but a good price for a shoulder MRI is about $550, $600. What we used to be paying for it through the PPOs at the big hospitals, the hospital would charge $4,000, the PPO would discount it down to $3,200, and then come and high-five us for what a great deal they got us. And then when you find out that a facility that accepts cash or is willing to deal with you honestly and openly, I've had those facilities tell me that actually their cost, their break even, is about $425. And so when an employee kind of starts to be price aware, they may be scheduled to have a procedure done at a certain facility that is not one that's competing on price and quality, but they would say, if, you know, kind of like Dr. Smith had said, if when somebody has got that plane ticket to Oklahoma City in the other and the price sheet in the other hand and saying hospital step up, we're starting to see that. We're starting to see employees of our employers say, you know, I may live in Woodward, Oklahoma, which is 3 hours from Oklahoma City, and I really don't want to leave my facility, but I can see on the Kempton Group website that I can have a hip replacement done at a world-class facility for $29,000, they're asking the question to their local hospital, what do you charge? Because I know I have some known good offers out here. Hospitals, they will look at, if you say, what do you charge? Because I know what you should charge. They look at you like you have a horn growing out of your forehead because no one's ever had that kind of ammunition. They don't deal with an informed buyer generally, especially not an informed individual. And more times than not, if they say, well, if you want me to do my procedure here, you're going to have to get very, very close to what I can have it done in Oklahoma City. We're seeing more often than not that they'll price match. Very reluctantly, but they will because they know they're making money even at that price. But without that, we're going to just see more of the cost inflation because there's so many people being enriched when the prices are high. That's kind of my song and dance. I think you said I have 15. I probably went 20, knowing me. But I think was the kind of the format, Jim, to open up to questions or?
Yeah, we'll open the floor.
Okay.
You said you take private insurance.
Yes.
Are you being subjected to clawback audits after payment by those insurance companies?
You have to
companies?
Define. Say again. I don't understand your language.
An insurance company makes a payment to you.
Yes.
Later they come in and start auditing all your records and then suddenly find that it was medically inappropriate to
yes.
pop all their money back.
Yes.
Are you being subjected to that?
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay.
Much better.
Earlier, I believe it was you that mentioned the
yes.
Samaritan. Do you, can you talk about it at all? I mean, I've just looked at a little bit of it. I have really not a whole lot understanding of it. But
sure.
it just sort of looks like everybody throws their money in a pot and somehow it gets paid.
It's a little bit like that. For I happen to know a little bit about it because a local family is doing it, and actually my daughter and son-in-law are about to do it. They've been researching it. For a family, doesn't matter how many kids, I think it's about $350 a month. And for that, what will happen is, if anyone has a need, you send that $350, 11 out of the 12 months, you send it to the person who actually needs the money for their health care. And then once a year, you send the money to the Samaritan offices. Also, there is a proviso, I guess, that if for catastrophic care, if you will agree to put $400 a year aside and for 3 years total, then if anyone in the system has a catastrophic need and you send them money for that catastrophic need, it comes out of a different pool, and then you, I assume for life, are then guaranteed catastrophic care if you ever need it too. There are also what's wonderful about it, they have people use their, when it comes to pharmaceuticals, they try to get you to, be cost conscious, use things responsibly. They ask you not to abuse alcohol, not to smoke. There are certain things that you agree to do, and it's about people being reasonable. So again, what I said was Samaritan has been in business at least 30 years. There are three health maintenance or health provider organizations, health sharing networks, excuse me, that the Obama care allowed to exist. They grandfathered them in. There are only three. And again, from what I understand, only one would possibly meet your needs, doctrinally. So that anything else about it? That's really about all I know. I haven't researched it that much.
It's mainly for individuals, though. Is that correct? That was my
yes,
understanding.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, and we are on. They contacted us. We are on their website. They have identified us as kind of a low cost, high quality provider, and so they're actually kind of shutting up. We did like four Samaritan patients this past month.
Doctor, without getting too personal, as far as your income, how does this compare to if you were working for a normal insurance situation versus this? Has your income changed very drastically?
Yes, my income has gone down. if you look at when we started the surgery center 17 years ago, it was not like this at all. The hospitals weren't, and the insurance companies weren't excluding people from coming to us. And so again, like I said on the video, I think we were maybe about half price compared to the hospitals. But then as things started getting more egregious and this whole system that I went through got kicked in, the price differences started really. And we had a a national consulting firm come through and take the 20 top surgical procedures, and they are the ones that told us that we were 1/6 to 1/8 the price of the hospitals. So anyway, as we've done this and we've gone to this you know, more cash-based model, again, we still take insurance. But what's happened is our business kind of went through a slump because the insurance companies were avoiding us. And it didn't make any sense to us because we knew we had a better product for less money. And that's one of the things, that's what started us putting our prices on the internet, because we thought, no, wait, this doesn't make sense. They should be lining up out our door, but instead it was just the opposite. The insurance company was trying to make people not come to us. And we said, okay, something's wrong with the system. So the reason that we put our prices online were to expose what's going on. We thought, you know, if we make our prices overt, and again, so businesses, Canadians came, businesses came, because again, they're identifying just what we talked about before. So I will tell you honestly that when we first began, my income was higher than it is now. But when we put these cash prices, we said, what's reasonable? And so when you see those global fees, we put reasonable prices down, and our margin is not very big for profit on the surgery center, you know, for buying, you know, all the things that we need, all the supplies and you know, just for capital expenditure. So it really is minimal. And we have a lot of people that try to piggyback off of us to try to take part of our experience, but they want a piece of our pie. And we say, you know what, if you add value in any kind of way to the healthcare puzzle, then please come on board. But we have our margins and we can't go a whole lot lower. So anyway, I don't know if I'm kind of answering, but that help. I mean, when we took this, I mean, we kind of took a little bit of a risk, and again, my income's down, but I'm still making a living. Did I answer? I mean, I don't know why you asked the question. Did it kind of help for whatever reason?
Obviously, you know, I just want to know if you can make more money doing it the Obama way versus the Catholic way.
The Obama way would be no. It would be worse. My partner Keith Smith, before we started the surgery center, he stopped accepting Medicare because we were both doing cardiac anesthesia. And you know, all it takes, you know, you're in the operating room for one of those cases, you know, 4 or 5 hours, it's pretty intensive, and you get a check from Medicare, you know, for $150, and you just kind of think, no, I'm not playing this game. Okay? And that's realistic. So Obamacare will be the same. And by the way, we feel really certain that Obamacare was meant to fail, that all it's there for, because you look at it statistically, it can't happen, right? So we think that it was meant to fail so that they could usher in single payer. And if you look at the insurance companies, the BUCAs, you call them, Blue Cross, United, Cigna, and Aetna, they were all behind Obamacare. And why? Because when it goes to single payer, then they can divide up the country into four, and they can all administrate, you know, a quadrant of the country. That's what we think.
One thing that was said when Steve was answering that question that I want to kind of highlight just real quick is when Steve made the comment that when they knew that their prices were 1/6 to 1/8 below the other competitors in their market space, and their quality was very, very high, it was frustrating and completely counterintuitive. Is why aren't insurance companies beating a path to our door? And the same thing, we are not an insurance company, but we do rent discounts from insurance companies. And no one ever told us about Surgery Center of Oklahoma. Nobody said, oh, if you want to really save money, you need to send patients over here. Why wouldn't they do that? I'm hiring them to save us money. And that's when my eyes started to be opened up. And that is, insurance companies don't just make money off the premium that you pay them. It's becoming increasingly clear that they make money off of that margin between the bill charge and the discounted charge and that repricing. They do the same thing on pharmaceutical, which you mentioned. But you can see that when you have a facility that, again, is either too ethical or too stupid, you're in good company with me, and is trying to do the right thing, you are a fly in the ointment. You are not to be highlighted. They hope that you'll just kind of go away, because you do expose, you by contrast, what is happening in the other facilities. There's no, if you're already low cost and high quality, there's no need for a discount. And if you're your job is to sell fictional discounts, you don't have a lot of need for Surgery Center of Oklahoma.
And if I could add, just so what was happening in Oklahoma, it's illegal to say you cannot go to the Surgery Center of Oklahoma, but what they would do is, and again, let's just take a knee scope. A knee arthroscopy at Hospital X would be $25,000, and let's say it's $4,000 at the Surgery Center. So what they would do is they'd say, okay, if you go to Hospital X, you know, they're in network, so it's $1,000 deductible, and we'll pay 80%, you pay 20%. But if you go to the Surgery Center of Oklahoma, it's a $3,000 deductible, and we're only going to pay 50%. Now, lots of times, even with that formula, okay, being a $4,000 surgery versus a $25,000 surgery, if we had time to educate the patient, we could often save them a lot of money. But again, but what Jay's talking about, why would the insurance companies play that game when we could obviously be saving the patient, the employer, whomever, lots and lots of money? So you just have to know, and that's why I told a big long story, that there are other ways that they are making lots more money than saving you money. Okay.
In your video, the Hospital Association made the claim that indigent care was a cost. I guess it was a factor in their need to have other funds coming in, so they needed this profit center in order to fund their other. Right. Business, and they essentially said you're cherry picking by taking that profit margin away from them. How do you respond to that? Are they really? Is there a huge cost on the indigent care for the hospitals? I mean, the ones around here don't seem like they make a lot of money.
Right. Okay. There's a few ways to answer that question. I know Forbes did a study about, I'm going to say, 4 years ago now. Because that's a claim the hospitals use, they're doing all this indigent care. Forbes pointed out that it's not true. I mean, it's just not the facts. So that's one. Two, if we are charging a sixth to an eighth of the price, who's really being charitable? Okay, it's cherry picking. Okay, you're picking the ripest cherry. If we were taking rich people, and that's all we were doing, if we were kind of concierge. Medicine, which we're not. We are actually the exact opposite. I mean, and I could go through, and it'd be self-serving examples, but I could just give you example after example after example of the people who come to us because they cannot afford the hospitals. And one of our probably second fastest growing population at the surgery center are those people that have health insurance, but as their deductibles and premiums go up, they can come to the surgery center and pay our cash prices for less than their deductible at the hospital. So, you know, we love for people to ask the cherry-picking question because it really is just the opposite. And I'm guessing that article in Forbes was about 4 years ago. But again, it would they are nonprofits. You know, all the hospitals, for the most part, are nonprofits. They use accounting principles that we cannot use in our business, okay? And again, the games they're playing, I mean, in Oklahoma City, we joke about it, Keith and I, but there is a crane in front of every hospital. They complain that they're losing money in the emergency rooms. Why did St. Anthony's Hospital just build like four freestanding emergency rooms around the city? to lose more money, I suppose, right? So it really is a farce, and you really just have to be careful about what you hear as fact and what you hear as fiction.
I think there is another part of that, though, that maybe what you're alluding to is, and I'm not a hospital administrator and definitely don't play one on TV, but the rural hospitals, the smaller facilities, I think they're struggling mightily. I see it in Oklahoma, I see it in Texas, and Steve and Dr. Smith have educated me a little bit on this, but the Medicare reimbursements at a rural hospital are far less than the Medicare reimbursements for the same procedure at a large hospital. And I believe it has to do with a lot of factors that the government looks at. But Keith tells the example of the Medicare reimbursement at Integris Hospital, which is the largest hospital in Oklahoma. The Medicare reimbursement for a given procedure, Medicare reimbursement for a given procedure at the largest hospital in Oklahoma, is that the cash price at Surgery Center of Oklahoma for the same procedure is half the Medicare reimbursement. And so through the kind of the funny bookkeeping that they're able to do, they are able to manipulate that Medicare reimbursement up if they're a large enough facility that it has enough volume. You're not going to be able to do that in St. Mary's, Kansas. You're not going to be able to do that in Stigler, Oklahoma. It's just not going to happen. Your patient mix, you're going to have so many more of those Medicare folks that you're just not going to be able to make it up with the, you just don't have the other volume. So I think your point is, I think it varies by metro or rural. This gentleman's coming up. Steve's comment about the cranes. I'll tell you, from Oklahoma City to San Antonio, all up and down that I-35 corridor, it's absolutely right. Everybody's, remember all the highway signs that have the big blue H on them for hospital? We do joke that up and down the I-35 corridor, you don't need to look for the H on the side of the road. If you're hurt, just drive toward the cranes because there'll be a hospital or two underneath them.
Mm. So after paying for 7 knee surgeries, I'm sick. But really, you talk about medical procedures, the arms, the shoulders. But what about within the healthcare, the drugs that are sustainable? Because what you see in the cost right now is you used to see co-pays of $25, $50, where now they've taken us to co-insurance of, okay, so now your prescription for a diabetic medicine is $700.
You
and
must
you're
be
pay
on
a
Blue Cross.
Co-pay. No, I'm not.
You're not? Okay.
No.
We see a lot of the percent of cost.
Yeah, so now the percent of cost is, well, you don't have to pay any more than $200 every quarter or every, your 90-day prescription. So, are you doing anything, or what's the solution from those maintenance drugs that people need from, let's say, a diabetic or something else that
you answer.
Okay. Is sustaining their life?
Yeah, I mean, pharmaceutical is kind of an itch that we don't know how to scratch. For facilities like Surgery Center of Oklahoma or a McBride or an Oklahoma Heart, they are the ones that are actually producing, they are the one that, they're the supplier of the product. When you're buying drugs from a Walgreens or a CVS or Jim Bob's Pharmacy on the corner, you're not purchasing it from the manufacturer or the supplier of that drug. There's 16 layers between the retail and the manufacturer. I think what it would take a manufacturer to grow a conscience and choose to do business directly with, basically become have a retail outlet, if you will, a manufacturer's retail outlet for drugs where you can start to see what the true cost is. The problem is a lot of drugs don't have competition. So there's no way to drive down the cost, and also there's so many fingers in the distribution channel that no drug manufacturer is willing to upset the apple cart with all of their partners out there that are helping to distribute those drugs. Some of those distribution channels in and of themselves are gigantic corporations. And yeah, like I said, it is a nut we don't know how to crack.
I'm sorry, but isn't that the carrot, because they put the prescription drugs associated to your medical? And so in order to get your prescription, you have to choose X, Y, and Z medical so that you can maintain that prescription.
Yeah, that's part of it. Yeah, it definitely is. I think that does occur. You know, you're going to see more of that. And we don't have time to go into it, but Steve and I talked about it on the way home, or the way up here. With Obamacare, the insurance carriers have, this is kind of, it sounds great on the Today Show, but in actuality, it's not good. And that is, Obamacare does, they have consumer protections, which limit the amount of tools in the insurance company's toolbox to manage costs. And so if they don't have less tools to be able to manage costs, they're kind of left with one big tool. And that one big tool is if you're a leukemia patient and there are four drugs that can be used to treat your type of leukemia, and two of them are very, very high and two of them are less expensive, Obamacare says that you have to offer coverage for leukemia. The carriers, in order to manage the cost, will just say, you know those two expensive drugs? They're excluded from coverage. We still cover leukemia. We just cover the old drugs and not the new, more effective drugs. Can we blame the carriers? I'd like to, because I don't like carriers. But honestly, they've been kind of driven to that. And so, yeah, being able to eventually, you're not going to have very many options, though. I think the carriers are just, they're starting to be homogenized, where you're going to have a hard time finding, carriers that are going to cover the more expensive drugs. It's going to end up being out of your pocket, if that's possible.
I should have put Big Pharma under MamaCare, but anyway, I thought I had enough stuff. A quick story that illustrates what Jay's talking about, all the fingers in the till. This woman got stung by a scorpion in South Texas. She had to have two doses of antivenom. Each dose of antivenom cost her $40,000. The administration cost was $20,000. So here's this woman with a $100,000 bill. They pay $56,000 or something, I'm forgetting the numbers now, but pay like about $56,000. The hospital came after her and was going to bankrupt her until people finally kind of got involved. But here's the deal. Across the border in Texas, that same antivenom was $100.
In Mexico.
In Mexico. The same antivenom was $100 a dose, not $40,000. But in the United States, there's only one company that sells it, and they mark it up to $3,900. So the hospital gets it for $3,900 and sold it for $40,000. So everybody kept, just adding and adding and adding. And that's the kind of thing that we're talking about.
One other, we try to tell you all these stories, hopefully just to be thought-provoking. But if you're an individual, this is important to you. If this is, and you're paying for your own health care, if you're an employer that is self-insured or is looking to be self-insured, this is very important to you. If you're an individual just with a carrier, a lot of this stuff is gee whiz information, but honestly, you don't have a lot of control because you don't have a lot of options. But back on this markup of the one supplier, one of the pet peeves that we have, because we see where those dollars go, is we see that a lot of implantable devices, and an implant is not what we probably would pop into our minds immediately, but an implantable device is anything that's designed to be left inside the human body. Is that right? Mm-hmm. Good definition for a layman. So it could be a heart stent. It could be a rod in your back. It could be a knee joint. It could be all sorts of different things. But we see implantable devices when you go to the hospital or a facility and have an implant installed, we'll see that is three quarters of the hospital bill. And traditionally, you just go, gosh, that was an expensive hospital bill. Look at how expensive that rod and three screws was. And about 2 years ago, 3 years ago, we really started seeing that that was becoming a huge chunk of dollars for our employers out there. And we started doing some investigation. And we started asking the hospitals, do you all make those screws and rods and stuff, or do you buy them? Oh, they're all custom made, every single one of them. I'm going to tell you a little bit of a story, but you get the impression that, yeah, we have fairies that are pounding them out of pixelated fairy dust in the basement. And they're completely one-offs, they're coated with unobtainium, and they're very exotic. And that's why they cost $90,000 for two screws. Part of the unveiling of this was actually at my Bible study. I had Bible study with one of the gentlemen that was in there. Actually was a rep. You all may have done business with him, but he was a rep, sold implants to hospitals, orthopedic implants. And his name was Sonny, and I had one of these giant bills, and I had just heard the story about the fairies making this stuff with unobtainium. And I took that bill to Bible study, and I said, Sonny, I said, I need a sanity check on this. I mean, this just seems so expensive for this. Can you take a look at this? And I had actually requested an itemized bill from the hospital, which is like pulling hen's teeth. I had to wait about a month to get that. And I actually I don't know if it was on purpose or an accident, but they actually gave me a part number for this device, for these parts. And I showed that to Sonny. He goes, oh, yeah, hang on, let's go back in my office, my home office. He goes in there, and this guy's kind of old school, so he had a rack of books. I felt like I was at, like, a Napa. And he's thumbing through these like we're looking for a carburetor, and he finds the manufacturer, because he recognized the part number, because he knew what it was for. It was, you know, he recognized the usage, and he finds the suggested retail price for this. And he said, I just want you to know that the hospital, they don't pay the suggested retail. They buy a lot of volume, and we give them incentives, dealer incentives, just like a car dealership. And I was thinking, you do? He's like, yeah. He said, I sell these out of the trunk of my car. He said, they order them, and Steve, you and Keith had verified that. They order them. They know the surgeries that they have coming up. The supplier comes to the hospital and wheels them in on a cart. They unbox them, sterilize them, put them in. But when I saw the differential between what the suggested retail price was, which he informed me that they take a pretty mighty lick at retail. I mean, that's got a markup already built into it. And then when I saw what the hospital was charging my employer, I mean, we're talking markups in the 800 to 900% range. But never fear, the PPO was there to give me a 30% discount, which I paid for. And that's where I started becoming motivated to upset the apple cart and to dig. And it seems like every few months, as you've got the bad guy and the good guy, or the good guy and the bad, you know, we're supposed to not like each other, but when we start talking a little bit, working for the common good of our employers out there, you start to compare notes about what suppliers have told you and what carriers have told you. Well, what'd they tell you? Well, they told me this. And you find out that there's a lot of moving parts in this that are not good for you or me. And it's not as much a mystery today as to why healthcare costs are as high as they are. It's by design.
I forgot to tell you all the good news. Jay says that there are two facilities in the state of Kansas, owned by the same people, I think, but that are trying to follow our model. And they're surgery centers?
One surgery center. They have two locations. One in, I think it's pronounced Galena, far southeast corner of Kansas, and then they have another facility in Joplin, and they called me after seeing one of y'all's videos, and they're working on bundling their pricing, so maybe it's spreading.
I have one last question, actually, that came in by text. It's a pretty specific question. Do any of the hospitals in your group do orthodontic oral surgeries?
Yes.
They do? Okay. They do. That was the specific question.
Great.
So if no one else has any more questions, I think we're going to go ahead and close the meeting. Thank you, gentlemen, very much for coming. An excellent talk.